Hello everyone, I am Rajeshwari Moganti, professor at the Department of Biochemistry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Now this module is number is 24 on different types of calorimetry and introducing you to the method of calorimetry. Now this is on in the paper on thermodynamics. And before we do the introduction to this particular module, I would like to tell you that this paper is on thermodynamics. As you know, because you have already done 23 modules in this paper, you know that thermodynamics deals with the heat changes, right? So if you are studying the heat changes, you have to determine them quantitatively. So any reaction, thermodynamics plays an important role. Therefore, heat changes, measurements of heat changes is crucial. Now, for this, the heat change for any reaction is quantitatively different, whether it could be a macroscopic level or it could be a microscopic level. So, the techniques to measure these are obviously different because each technique has its own advantages as well as disadvantages. So, I have sort of allotted 5 modules on this. This is the first one, then we will do the isothermal calorimetry, then differential scanning calorimetry and also the practical application, practicals. So, with that this thing, I would like to start this, that how does actually calorimetry differ from other measuring techniques. Now, first thing before we start, I have to tell you that one has to use the word calorimetry very carefully because it cannot be used in synonymous with calorimetry, which you studied in spectroscopy and other methods, biophysical techniques. Because calorimetry, spell it clearly, because don't use it so loosely or rather interchange the words. Calorimetry deals with the measurement of color using the absorption technique, but calorimetry, as the word says, it is a calorie measurements, that is you are measuring the heat changes which can be converted into heat, calories or the energy. Therefore, calorimetry, you have to use the word very carefully. Now, with that, calorimetry is actually a technique which is non-invasive, so it is also non-destructive. It doesn't dissociate the sample or anything like that. So it is a non-destructive as well as non-invasive method. So it is one of the very good techniques, and also that you can study chemical, physical, biological properties. Everything can be studied. There is no limitation on the method of the choice of the sample or the property you are studying. Now, the third is, it is not dependent on the physical shape of the molecule. Irrespective of the shape, any molecular can be studied. Now, different forms of the samples also can, whether it is in a solid, liquid or a gaseous substances, you can determine the calorimetry, you can use the calorimetry. And the next one is that no chemical derivatization or immobilization is required. You don't need to do anything with the sample, but as such, whatever is the sample you want to study can be studied. No need of modifications or anything for any protein, anything like that. So, that is one advantage. The next one is that it is non-specific. What does it mean? Non-specific means no chemical reaction mechanisms are involved. We only look at the heat change irrespective of whatever chemical reaction that is going on. It could be a biochemical reaction, it could be an organic reaction, irrespective, you are just only looking at the heat changes. So, it does not really bother about the chemistry part of it, irrespective. That is very important in the whole thermodynamics. Then there are techniques which are called microcalorimetry, because as its name suggests, you can measure very small changes of the heat changes that continuously and directly measure the processes which you have to study in a real time. Real time means as a function of the reaction is going on, with a real time you can determine. It is in a sophisticated technique. We will be doing it in the 25 and 26 modules. Now, the calorimetry therefore measures the changes, whereas most other techniques actually measure the state of a system. So, whether it is in which state, whether it is in a bound state, unbound state, or it is in a reaction, what kind of changes that are happening, calorimetry just does not bother. It just measures the changes very as per the directly not dependent on the change of a system. So based on this with this introduction and importance of this module, the objectives are laid out as such, like this, that firstly we will do the mechanism of heat transfer in a chemical reaction, then we will study the Hess law, and then heat capacity. I will introduce you to the terms heat capacity and specific heat, both are different. Then also introduction to the calorimetry method, what is actually does, what does it do, then different types of calorimeters, constant pressure calorimeter, then reaction calorimeter and the constant volume calorimeter, then of course a very popular one, bomb calorimeter, for to determine the key changes, and then of course how bomb calorimetry can be used, what are its applications, both in terms of the biological samples as well as in the industrial applications, which is a very very simple one, which actually measures the macroscopic heat changes in a chemical reaction. Now, the heat change, since we are going to measure the heat change, although you have studied little bit in the earlier these things modules, heat is actually a transfer of energy from one state to another. Okay, so if there is a, there can be, if it is changing from one state to another, or it is transferring the energy from one system to another, there is a heat transfer. Therefore, this is called the Q, or the measured amount given by the symbol Q. It could be an endothermic process or it could be an exothermic process. Now, this heat change flows from the continuously from one region, that is of a higher energy, to a lower energy, or in terms of temperature we call it a high temperature to a lower temperature. So, when the heat flows spontaneously from a region of high temperature to a region of low temperature, the direction of the heat flow, if it is an endothermic reaction, the heat change is greater than 0 on the left side, and the right side you see exothermic reaction where the Q of the system is less than 0. Examples are given: water, if when you heat it, it becomes ice, when you heat it, it becomes liquid, that is QS is greater than 0, whereas when water is freezed, frozen to ice from liquid to solid, then the heat is it is called exothermic and Q is less than 0. So, this is what is shown schematically. Direction of the heat flow from endothermic to endothermic changes to the system, and in an exothermic system reaction, the energy flows from the system to the surroundings. So, this is actually called in one of the first modules you must have studied, it is a closed system, because a closed system where there is no exchange, but in an open system like this, you have an exchange of heats. Conservation of energy in a chemical reaction. So, if you see, look at the energy in a system and then surroundings, the two energies are quantitatively different, but before the reaction and once a reaction occurs, after the reaction there is an exchange of energy, and therefore you see the energy content in the system and surroundings are different. Nevertheless, the total energy remains same. If you see the y axis, the two bars shown in this figure are same. So, the energy conserved, at the same time the energy is transferred from one system to another system while maintaining the total energy. So, this is an example of the energy of the reactant and product increases while the energy of the surrounding decreases. In this every case, however, the total energy does not change. This is an important thing to mention. Heat of a reaction. Therefore, when you talk about the heat of a reaction, enthalpy change of a reaction is commonly known as heat reaction. And exothermic refers to delta H equal to 0, as we mentioned earlier, Q, or you can even say delta H, because delta H actually deals with the enthalpy. And therefore, delta H equal to heat of the products minus the heat of the reactants. What I have shown on the right side in the box is an example of a reaction where the sodium plus water, if you add water to the sodium, there is a change in energy. Delta H is minus 368.6 kilojoules. That means that much energy has been, heat is been released. So, you always have to mention it in terms of the in terms of the kilojoules, that is one of the units to express energy. The reactants are on the top, products are in the bottom. Therefore, the products have less enthalpy than the reactant. So, enthalpy is evolved as a heat, and the signs in both Q and DH are negative. Heat capacity and specific heat, these two terms continuously come in the thermodynamics, and heat capacity is the heat required to raise the temperature of a body by 1 degree centigrade. That means it is an extensive. So, C equal to, that is the heat capacity, Q by delta T. So, that is what is the heat capacity, while specific heat is different. Specific heat is actually represented by sigma, the heat required to raise 1 gram of the substance to 1 degree of centigrade. So, this becomes an intensive property because you are giving the heat per 1 gram, you are specifying the amount of energy per gram. So, it becomes an intensive property, and that can be shown as the amount of heat energy gained or lost by a substance is equal to mass of the substance into m into C into delta T. Now, there is one more term called molar heat capacity. Now, specific heat, or you can also call it as specific heat capacity, that is only for 1 gram. But normally when we compare with two substances heat capacities, it is always better to express in molar, because by moles it is, you are always keeping it as 1 mole of the substance. So, as the name suggests, the specific heat is molar heat capacity is the heat required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of the substance by 1 degree centigrade. So, you can actually write the same from using the specific heat, Q equal to Cm, that is the moles, concentration in mole into delta T. Now, the standard heats of formation, this is one thing which is also commonly heard in thermodynamics. Now, standard heat of formation, this is the energy, that is enthalpy change for the formation of 1 mole of substance in its standard state. Now, what is the standard state? I will just tell you, from its constituent elements in their standard states. So, both are in the standard state, or you can be more clear or more specific in its definition. The standard heat of formation is actually defined as amount of heat absorbed or evolved at 25 degree centigrade, that is at 1 atmospheric pressure. These are the two, these things, that are room temperature and 1 atmospheric pressure is usually called the standard state of when 1 mole of the compound is formed from its constituent elements. That means each substance being in its normal physical state, whether it could be a gas, it could be a liquid or a solid. So, the standard state are normally referred to as room temperature RT, the 25 and 1 atmospheric pressure. Now, the standard heat of combustion, so what is, it is very simple to understand, is similarly defined as amount of heat evolved at 25 degree centigrade and at 1 atmospheric pressure when 1 mole of a substance is burned in excess of oxygen. So, delta F for elements in most stable state is defined by delta FF, HF, that is a symbol. So, a simple law based on the theory we just talked about, this is called Hess law. What is Hess law state? Is Hess law states that the heat of a whole reaction is equivalent to the sum of its individual steps. So, if you talk about C carbon plus oxygen gives CO2, then the what it tells you is that if you take C plus half O2, which gives CO, that is one reaction, then the CO second step, as you see in the equation, another oxygen, half oxygen, that is one O, one atom, gives CO2. That means basically it could be considered in two reactions. The first one with -110 kilojoules, the second one is at -283 kilojoules. So, if you combine these two, this kind of coupling of reactions is important. You will be studying it in the ATP and biological process, ADP to ATP and all. So, always use this coupling reaction. So, C plus CO plus O2, you can get it as CO plus CO2. So, the whole enthalpy can be a total sum. So this is where delta H becomes 393 point kilojoules. So basically the Hess law allows us to add equations, but you cannot add left and right together. Left can be added all together on left side of the of a reaction, and right side components can be added in the same reaction, so that all the left we can be summed up to get an equal reaction. So we add all reactants and products to get a delta H value. Now I will come to, with those small introduction, I will tell you what is a calorimetry method. A calorimeter may be used to determine heat capacity of a material by measuring the temperature changes when a known mass of the material at a higher temperature is placed in known mass of the water, usually at room temperature, and the system is allowed to reach a final intermediate temperature. So basically you are bringing it to an equilibrium, because one hot subject is losing to the heat to the surroundings, that is water, and therefore both retain the same temperature at an intermediate temperature, which is actually at equilibrium. So this is what is shown. It is a very simple method, rather very primitive and crude method, I would say. The heat capacity is related to atomic mass and the intermolecular forces in the material. So you can just measure with a thermometer and then see how much heat is, how much the temperature has risen, and from that you can calculate. But of course, the main important phenomena in this is that to keep the surroundings in a very temperature sensitive, so that they do not lose to the surroundings, but only to the medium where you are placing the subject. So calorimetry, we call it as a non-specific technique, which means it could reach by process 1 or process 2. Ultimately, both the processes will become add up, and therefore process 1 plus 2. So this is simply very clearly shown diagrammatically, rather graphically. With time if you measure the heat flow of any process, and therefore heat flow on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. Calorimetry is sensitive to all physical chemical processes associated with the heat flow. Thus, the monitored heat flow may contain contributions from several processes. Individual contributions may be distinguished by varying the experimental conditions. This is a very historical slide. Lavoisier and Laplace, they have actually initially done it in those days. The sophisticated systems were not available. So, they just made one simple crude ice calorimeter, where they determined the heat. This tells you that how old is this one, and therefore their experiments are actually classic experiments, and they have these experiments has actually generated, or rather the new branch of chemistry that is called the thermochemistry has actually evolved from these experiments. A huge plethora of studies have been done both in chemistry as well as in biochemistry based on these experiments. So it is really remarkable to remember Laplace and Lavoisier heat experiments at this point of time. So, one of the initial calorimeters were the adiabatic calorimeter. As you can see here, it is just that you keep a wedge shaped one, you keep it in the water, and then you have a heating coil, and then you of course measure a thermometer, keep a thermometer in the water, then a stirring, so that uniformity is maintained. So, this is actually, this adiabatic calorimeter is used to examine runway reactions. Since the calorimeter runs in adiabatic environment, any heat that is generated by the material sample under test tube, the sample to increase the temperature, therefore the fueling the reaction, and no adiabatic calorimetry is fully adiabatic, because it is impossible to really keep the surroundings completely control the heat loss. You can only control the heat loss, but you cannot make the heat loss to zero. So, it is not possible to completely separate the heat loss. Therefore, some heat will be lost, some amount, maybe minor quantity, but it will be lost by the sample to the sample holder. Of course, we try to ignore that in a initial experiments. If the heat change is higher, then you can actually afford to ignore that. A mathematical correction factor, therefore, known as a phi factor, can be used to adjust the calorimetric result to account for these kind of heat losses. If the heat change is not very high, then you need to use phi factor. Phi is actually the ratio of thermal mass of the sample and sample holder to the thermal mass of the sample alone. So, that will give you some amount of correction. Then comes the reaction calorimeter. I am just trying to introduce you to various calorimeters which are evolved with time, and each one has been used for different, designed for different experiments. The reaction calorimeter is a calorimeter in which a chemical reaction is initiated within the closed insulated container. So, the reaction heats are measured and the total heat is obtained by integrating the heat flow versus time. And this is a standard used in generally in industries to measure heats of the industrial process are engineered to run at constant temperatures. Now, the reaction calorimetry can also be used to determine maximum heat release rate for a chemical process engineering and for tracking the global kinetics of the reactions. There are mainly four types of reaction calorimeters, and I would just like to mention each of them with a brief just rush you through the different types of thing, because this module is meant to only to introduce you to different types of macro calorimeters are not really much used nowadays in biological chemistry. The four main methods for measuring the heat on a reaction calorimeter are: first one is a heat flow calorimeter, the second is the heat balance calorimeter, power compensation and constant flux. Remember that you do not have to remember the definitions or mug up the definitions, but the root word, if you remember, that itself will give you what kind of calorimeter or on what principle it is being designed to. The heat flow calorimeter or the cooling or the heating jacket controls either the temperature of the process or the temperature of the jacket. Therefore, heat flow is actually measured. Heat is measured by monitoring the temperature difference between heat transfer of the fluid and the process fluid. In addition, it also measures the fill volumes and specific heat transfer coefficient that have to be determined to arrive at a correct value. It is possible with this type of calorimeter to do reactions at reflux, although accuracy is not very good. The second one is a heat balance calorimeter. The cooling heating jackets are controlled, and then heat is measured by monitoring the heat gained or lost to the by the transfer of the fluid. Third is a power compensation. Power compensation uses a heater placed within the cell, and that to maintain a constant temperature. This is actually also will be used later in microcalorimetry, a similar principle. The energy supplied to this heater can be varied as the different reactions actually require different amount of energy that are released or absorbed. Therefore, this kind of a calorimetry is actually you are compensating by giving a different amount of energy by compensating the heat difference or the energy change. And this could be also from the electrical supply by using any thermocouple or something. The fourth one is a constant flux. Constant flux calorimetry or the coflux, it's generally referred to as, is derived from the heat balance calorimetry, and this uses specialized control mechanisms to maintain a constant heat flow across the vessel wall. Tells you how the heat flow changes with time, shows energy versus time, heat flow versus energy. Therefore, this can show that P equal to K into U. This is a first order reaction. Now, we will come quickly to the constant pressure calorimeter. Here it is also called the coffee cup, normally has a negligible heat capacity compared to the system being studied. A coffee cup or a more accurate device efforts us to at a constant pressure measurement of heat transfer or a delta H value for a physical or chemical change. Such a calorimeter is suited for studies where the reactants do not need to be confined and great accuracy is not required. The coffee cup reactions are given. These are typically of chemistry and inorganic chemistry reactions. and some of the examples I have given here. I have given just an example which you can do on your own. If a numerical is given that and see that whether you can be able to calculate that how much change can the material that I have given is a gold changes, how much changes it experiences during the state of the matter. Then the bomb calorimeter, also the constant volume calorimeter. This is used to measure the enthalpy changes of a combustion reactions. In such studies, excess of oxygen is normally employed. Like for example, I have given you methanol plus oxygen and giving CO2 plus H2O. The same diagrammatic representation of bomb calorimeter is also given here. This occurs in a tiny inner metal chamber called bomb, and within that there is a water, there is a stirrer, and then a crucible where you keep the sample that is actually surrounded by a small reaction chamber that is called bomb. Then you have another insulated container. So the idea is to minimize the heat loss to the surroundings, and not to only the heat changes between the reactant and the reaction surrounded by the water is measured. Therefore, the bomb calorimetry is one of the most commonly used for a number of studies, but some of them I am mentioning, like in thermodynamic studies, combustion you can use, also in the metabolic studies you can use it for various metabolic processes where there is a for example, the food industries you can use, and how much energy that is being released. These kind of things you can use it where you do not need micro calorie measurements. So, with that I will conclude I will give you the summary. Heat transfer, therefore, I just mentioned to you various processes of heat transfer and the prediction and measurement of the heat effects which accompany in chemical changes are important to understand about the how the chemical and biological reactions take place. Then I also introduced you to the Hess law, where is one of the universal and simple equation where you can determine the two, you can actually combine, add up the two chemical reactions. Therefore, the heat changes can be actually added up on both the left and right side of a reaction. Any process that results in heat being generated and exchanged with environment is a candidate for calorimetric study. There are two types of calorimetry: measurement based on pressure, constant pressure, and measurements based on constant volume. And the bomb calorimeter is a simple type of constant volume calorimeter used most frequently in measuring the combustion of a particular reaction, combustion in industries, and also used in for the calorific value of any solid or a liquid, and also used in waste industries way to determine how much calorie, because they can be used to as a source of energy, and also refusal, waste disposal also you can use it to see. Thermodynamic studies and this is used in educational training, metabolic studies. The calorimetry, bomb calorimetry is the one which actually introduced in number of ways to at different levels, both in school or in higher studies. So, that's all in this chapter. Next, we will do the more sophisticated techniques. Thank you.